This picture shows steady groundwater flow in a recharged, unconfined aquifer bordered by two parallel, fully penetrating canals with equal water levels. The aquifer is homogeneous and isotropic, and the Dupuy-Forchheimer assumptions apply, same as with the steady unconfined groundwater flow that we discussed earlier. Again, we may combine Darcy's law for unconfined groundwater flow, taken as horizontal, as stated here, with the continuity equation for a recharge situation, Q with the prime equals n times x, where n is the recharge rate or precipitation surplus in meter per day, and x is the horizontal distance in meter. So both the horizontal Q with the prime and nx are in square meter per day. This delivers the following equation for the potentiometric surface. Please note that because the present flow case is symmetrical, the location of x is 0 is taken in the middle, where H0 is largest due to the recharge, and that groundwater flow is from the center of the aquifer in opposite directions to both canals. When H0, HL, and L are known values, C in this equation can be found by inserting the boundary conditions for this flow case. First insert the x is 0 mid boundary condition, and then the x is L boundary condition. Same as with the first derivation of the Dupuy-Forchheimer equation for unconfined groundwater flow in an earlier lecture, the horizontal length L of the aquifer must be at least 5 times larger than the saturated aquifer thickness G with a bar above it, which again we may take as H0 plus HL divided by 2. Define the convexity delta H as H0 minus HL, and split H0 squared minus HL squared as shown here, and this will deliver this equation. This equation is a simplified version of the Hooghoudt equation, named after the Dutch hydrologist Simon Barend Hooghoudt. This equation, shown here again, can be rewritten as shown here. This equation gives the drain spacing 2L, so this distance between drains or between these two ditches, as a function of the recharge rate n in meter per day and the convexity delta H in meter for an aquifer with a transmissivity Kd in square meter per day. As the land surface in polders should not be too wet in order to still allow for farming practices, this restricts the values for the convexity delta H. It is a very useful equation to determine the optimal distance between ditches that drain these polders. Typically, take the train from Utrecht to Amsterdam or for another part of the Western Netherlands, and you can see the meadows to be quite evenly partitioned by these ditches. This figure shows steady groundwater flow in a recharged, unconfined aquifer bordered by two parallel, fully penetrating streams, but with different water levels, as for instance in mountainous areas. The aquifer is homogeneous and isotropic, and also here the horizontal length of the aquifer must be at least 5 times larger than the saturated aquifer thickness in order for the Dupuy-Forchheimer assumptions to apply. Again, we can set up the water balance, shown here, for a vertical column or rectangle of the aquifer. You can think of this area constituting that rectangle. And then combine this with Darcy's law. You see Darcy's law stated here on the top lines to obtain this equation. Note that also here we are dealing with an unconfined aquifer. H and dH dx are taken together as one term. N is again the recharge rate or precipitation surplus in meter per day. And also note that for N is 0, we obtain the earlier equation H squared equals C1x plus C2, the equation for an unconfined aquifer between two parallel fully penetrating canals with different water levels, and as we now may add, with no recharge. So in actual fact, the earlier equation H squared equals C1x plus C2 can be regarded as a special case of this new groundwater flow case. Note that as this flow case is not symmetrical, the location of x is 0 is now taken to the left. And we find values of C1 and C2 by inserting the boundary conditions as explained earlier. First insert the left boundary condition and then the right one, etc. Also remember that from work by Hachima and others, as mentioned in an earlier lecture, a low average annual recharge rate in comparison with the aquifer's transmissivity is favorable for the establishment of such a recharge-controlled water table. All analytical equations derived thus far are based on simplifying assumptions. For instance, the Dupuy-Forchheimer assumption of horizontal groundwater flow in an unconfined aquifer. Canals, in reality, may not be fully penetrating, and streamlines in an unconfined aquifer are not horizontal, but slightly bent, slightly longer, and contracting near the canal, causing an extra flow resistance. Also, the canals may, for instance, be lined with less permeable material, also causing an extra resistance, leading to a seepage phase, which is a steeper hydraulic gradient near the outflow boundary of an aquifer to open water. To account for deviations from reality, an extra resistance, omega, may be built into the Darcy or Laplacian equation. As an example, here we have the equation for steady groundwater flow in a recharged, unconfined aquifer. Remember, C in this equation can be found by inserting the boundary conditions. First insert the x is 0 mid boundary condition, and then the right x is L boundary condition. This gives the second equation, which can, for a polder landscape if so desired, be rewritten to produce this optimal drain spacing 2L between two ditches. If need be, we can build an extra resistance into this second equation. Note that L squared divided by double the transmissivity carries as units meter squared divided by meter squared per day, thus days as a unit of resistance. Simply add an extra resistance omega to this, with the same units of course, units of days, to account for the just discussed deviations of our models from reality, that is, what we measure or observe in the field.